So now we're going to go very quickly through what are the symptoms of ASD. Well, it could be anything to do with concern that lasts for more than 6 months about development in any of these ways. Have we agreed that these go out on some website? Yeah, so you don't need to write everything down if you're not the type of person like myself who will remember more if you write it down. General development or motor coordination or perception could be the things that are really concerning in the first few years of life. Communication and language, as I've already mentioned, and 2.5-year-olds, it is the best screener that you can have. If you really want to catch virtually all these children at any one age, screening for language delay at 2.5 will pick up more than 70% of all of them. But if you then want to also, at that time, pick up everyone with autism, you have to include an autism screen as well. You cannot just go for is language delayed or not, because there's a group, of course, as you know, with autism who are not language delayed and yet have autism and need a diagnosis early on. It could be activity or impulsivity or inattention. And when it comes to inattention, it's important to say that the usual problem that people are asking about is not hearing. So many of these kids have been to see ear, nose and throat specialists early on and been cleared, as it were. They have no hearing problem, and so everybody believes it's all fine. But actually many of them will later get a diagnosis of ADHD. So inattention is very often referred to as not hearing when you're under the age of 2, 2.5. Social interaction and reciprocity is becoming more and more of a concern in our country. Parents actually ask, could this be autism? I think it's very important to say that was not the case many years ago, but now it's one of the most common reasons for parents asking about their child's development in well baby clinics, for instance. It could be the stereotypic behavior, like insistence on sameness, and insistence on sameness in relation to food is something that I'll come back to later today, and is quite often the first sign of autism in individuals who also have eating problems, as we'll be talking later about. Mood swings and emotional dysregulation, and by the way, emotional dysregulation, that's become the new autism, as it were, the new popular thing. You'll hear so much about emotional dysregulation in the coming years, you'll be, oh my God, I can't listen to this anymore. Everything is being put down to early emotional dysregulation, like attachment in the past. Now it's emotional dysregulation. I'm not saying that's not true, though, because I think there's a lot to support the idea that early emotional dysregulation is a key feature of many of the things that we're talking about, and particularly, again, in ADHD and autism. And ADHD, the most common individual symptom that all children virtually with an early diagnosis of ADHD have in common is emotional dysregulation. They may not all have concentration difficulties, they may not all have hyperactivity, they may not all be impulsive, but virtually everyone has emotional dysregulation. And feeding and sleep. But again, this is when things have gone on for months and months and months, so half a year or more, or if it's of acute onset, like I said, with pants. Now, this horrible slide is something which I wanted to put everything that's actually known about autism on one slide. A lot of things about autism are still not known, but these things are actually known at this time. So we know that it's multifactorial. We know that there are several different presentations, even though we have a sort of common cookbook to say this is autism, like the DSM-5. Everyone who shows impairment in their functioning in the first few years of life has more than autism. if you have autism in the first 3 years of life, you meet full criteria for autism, it's 100% certain you're going to have more than just autism. And it's extremely important to understand that, well, these other things are also things that you can do something about, sometimes even more than you can do about the autism. And therefore, people cannot ever again be worked up or assessed for autism and everyone is, you know, happy with, this is all it is. It's never the only explanation in a child who presents at 2, 3, 4 years of age. There will be things like language delay or intellectual disability or ADHD or developmental coordination disorder, something else, not just the autism. And that's why it's important to say autism-specific services need to be aware of this essence sort of umbrella idea. We also know now that outcome in autism without any comorbidity can be fantastic, fantastically good, can be excellent. We know that if there are only autistic symptoms and nothing else, maybe it shouldn't be, even be diagnosed as autism because it's not clinically that impairing. And you can actually, even at the age of 3, have 100 symptoms, if you will, or at least 100 on a score for autism on one list, and 10 years later be absolutely fine if you have nothing else. So autistic features by themselves, they predict that you're going to be a little bit different than just about every normal person, but you're not going to be in trouble. Maybe you'll be, a genius or something, somebody who can produce things that other people would never have dreamt of, etc. And it's important, I think, to start to spread the word that it's autism plus that really matters, autism with other things. I'll come back to this later today. Impairments may increase or decrease over time, but in, at least in all the follow-up studies that we have done, and we've done many over the years, over the past 40 years, it's never the autistic preschool load that predicts the outcome. It's the presence of one of the other problems that we've mentioned that predicts outcome. ADHD, well, this is also a terrible slide, but if you look carefully at it, which you can do afterwards, either at the website or in some other way, you'll see that it's very similar to what's being said about autism. They are genetic, they're multifactorial. Again, the dividing line between normal and abnormal is blurred. You cannot say easily that this is where, you know, you draw the line and here are the ones who are normal, here are the ones who are abnormal. I showed this slide at the Emmanuel Miller Memorial Lecture almost 30 years ago in London, and people were outraged, saying, what? That's just crazy. To suggest that these things overlap, are you absolutely mad? But now, of course, I think most people would agree this is almost what it looks like, that they always overlap, and you cannot say for certain that here is pure this or pure that. And this is a slide to show that the autistic features, if you will, are normally distributed in the general population, and it's only when you get very far away from the mean or the median that people start thinking about, could that be Asperger syndrome? Or if you're even further removed from that mean or median of autistic features in the general population, people start saying maybe it's autism. Now, this slide is just to show you that exactly the things that I put on the slide for essence more generally are the things that could be the first symptoms of autism. Could be general development, could be motor, could be sensory, could be etc. And actually, the studies that have been performed seem to suggest that the most common early finding is abnormal motor development. Even those studies that have looked prospectively at videos of one-day-old babies who later get a diagnosis, comparing them blindly to those who don't get a diagnosis of autism, you'll see some strange motor behaviors in the autism group, but not in the other group, including things like no facial movements and a staring gaze. So how many people are affected in the general population by either ADHD, autism, intellectual disability, etc.? A total of about 10% at least meet criteria for one of these disorders. And in our country, at the age of 20, about 10% of the population have been registered with one of these diagnoses. At the age of 6, about half. So 5% of the general population of Swedish children have already been diagnosed and registered in the medical system as having autism or ADHD or intellectual disability. It's important also to say that if you look at that prevalence rate in the general population, you'll find it's only a small to moderate overrepresentation of males, not the kind of thing you hear about out in specialized clinics where people say, well, 3, 4, 5 times as many boys as girls under the age of 10 will get these diagnoses. Actually, it still is a problem that under the age of 10, it's usually boys who get these diagnoses. But if you follow up into adult age, actually more and more girls and women will get these diagnoses. But it's still a long way to go before all of the ones affected get the right diagnosis. They very often get diagnoses like depression, etc. If you're a girl, you're much more likely to be recognized as having depression and anxiety than as having autism or ADHD. Overlap and comorbidity is the rule, not the exception. When looking back, the vast majority had symptoms long before 5 years of age. Girls, unfortunately, still are usually not recognized until they become adolescent and even adults. And very often, depending on where you are, not even then as having autism or ADHD, but instead depression or anxiety. Now, this is a graph to show you, again, about normality. Like Lorna Wing used to say, there's a grain or a little bit of autism in each and every one of us. And that's absolutely true, because at least in Bergen, Norway, about 15 years ago, when we did this study, screening for autism in the general population, this is the result from 6,200 parents in the general population who screened their children for autism. And as you can see, zero symptoms of autism was no more than about 15% of the general population of 7 to 9 year old Bergen, Norway children, which means it's not normal to not have an autism symptom. So they're very abnormal, those, you know, who have that, those who have nothing, they're the really abnormal ones. So at least a little sort of smudge, if you will, of autism is what everyone should expect. And don't think that if you have a few autistic features, you're likely to be, you know, impaired by autism. And even in the group with, you know, more than 20 symptoms, there isn't even a hump on this, or maybe a little bit. But it's very difficult, according to something like this, to say, well, you could tell really that having over 20 must be abnormal. It's very difficult to draw the line. Where does it become abnormal to have autistic features? It was once believed to be the most severe, easily recognized and diagnosable disorder. But as I've already said, we've already found in the 1970s that 0.7% had autism. Just recently we proposed that people should perhaps start thinking at least about autism plus rather than autism only, so that people have it at the back of their minds that if it's impairing, it's always plus. It's always more than just autism. Maybe regressive autism is something completely different. And new studies that we're doing in collaboration with the French group suggests that the group with regressive autism, that is, who develop normally up until 18 to 30 months and then regress, they have a very different genotype. They have a genotype which is consistent with rheumatoid arthritis and have signs of neuroinflammation. So if that holds up in bigger studies, it's going to be important to show that regressive autism is absolutely different from the ones who have problems from the very beginning. Now, all of these, of course, now you know what this slide is going to show. where do they all come from? Well, from autism. There's been at least one dissertation, thesis, or book written about all of these individuals to show that they actually meet criteria for autism or for Asperger syndrome. And what do they have in common? Well, except perhaps, I show this slide when I'm in France, so I put on Alain Robbe-Grillet, who is a hero in France, but nobody's heard about him in the rest of the world. But anyway, they all are remembered. And Susan Boyle, of course, is the only one so far who's still alive. But she herself says, and her doctor says, and together they've said, that she has Asperger's syndrome. But the thing is, these people have contributed something that will be remembered for a very long time, maybe forever. And it's important to have that also with you when you think about this is the most devastating disorder, that also autism has something more to it than just devastation.